is a Monday morning, and as it is the fourth Monday of the month, we're pleased to welcome to the studio Dr. Eric Seward, OBGYN at Woodlawn Hospital, for our Doc Talk program. Doc, good morning.
Thank you. Good morning
to you. Yeah, nice to have you here today. Like we were just commenting, nice to see the sunshine, isn't it?
It's the first time I think the fourth Monday of a month has had sun, and I don't know when. I'm not sure that it's ever been sunny when I've come
in
here.
We'll start keeping track because we got one in a row going now.
Well, it's a streak.
That's right. It is definitely a streak. You have an interesting topic to pass along to the listeners today, and I want to remind the listeners, if you have a question, 223-6059. You can send it to WROI@RTCOL.com, or you can send it to our Facebook page. And, of course, this program not only on WROI, but soon to be on RTC Channel 4. We're audio live right now on 5. Hey, Scott, how you doing?
Good morning.
Welcome back.
It's good to be here.
Here we go. All right. Dr. Seward.
Well, last time that I was in, we spent some time talking about menopause.
Okay.
And probably the largest topic and one of the biggest pieces of my time spent, and a hot topic that has been talked about since I came into this field.
And even before,
is the topic of hormone therapy and hormone replacement. And the thinking has evolved over time.
Right.
It's one of these things, though, that doesn't have super clear answers. I think when people come to the doctor or they're thinking about medicine, they tend to be thinking in black and white terms. I think a lot of times they walk in the door and think there is an answer. And this is one of those shades of gray topics. At one point in time, if we look back to, say, the late 1980s, early 1990s, it was sort of considered to be a what we would call a panacea of good. And by that, I mean there wasn't anything about hormones that were looked at from a negative perspective. It seemed to be a tablet of health, a fountain of youth sort of remedy. And some of the basis for that were obvious things, like people went through menopause, they had symptoms from menopause. Sometimes it was things like there's a disparity between men and women with heart disease, as an example. And the big thought with that was the protection that women got with estrogen up till about the age of 50. And there were all sorts of theories that perhaps estrogen could be derived in some form of maybe a modified supplement that people could take to prevent heart disease. Everybody, and I think this goes way back into at least the early 1990s, if not before, had concerns about breast cancer. And that remains one of the most confusing items, and hopefully we'll get into that just a little bit. In medicine, we speak on a daily basis in terms of evidence. We like to say that word.
Sure.
And we talk about levels of evidence. We talk about how many, you know, double-blinded prospective studies have been done to kind of show something is right. And it's interesting. There's a mountain of literature, so to speak, on hormone therapy. Some of it better than others, some of it bigger than others, some of it better designed than others, but there's a mountain of information, and it is still confusing. And so I want to kind of have this talk to sort of maybe bring that into focus. There are a lot of women, if you look at the population dynamics, the folks that were baby boomers, sort of the back end of the baby boom generation, came around about the mid-1960s, and they're right now going through menopause.
Sure.
and so there are a whole lot of people out there that this applies to. It's, you know, people that are basically in my generation are kind of knocking on the door. So
can we make the point, too, that, and you probably did last time, but the menopause affects different women in different ways?
Sure it does, yeah. I think we talked a little bit about bell-shaped curves at some point. But, yeah, the average is about 50-51, but there's a range, and, you know, probably the largest chunk of that range is between maybe 45 and 55 with some stragglers out on the ends that still represent normal. when somebody goes through menopause, and we did discuss this last time, there are a lot of symptoms, hot flashes, night sweats. So I mentioned a little bit about heart disease. Okay. You start to see an increase in heart disease. Certainly, you see an increase in breast cancer. That's sort of a lifelong problem, and we discussed that in a previous episode, too. When you go through menopause, the real question is, what do you do? And there certainly was a time in our recent history where most doctors out there were just prescribing pills. Then it kind of the pendulum sort of swung back. I'll talk a little bit about why. Okay. But about 10 years ago, nobody was prescribing pills. It was sort of a almost a taboo topic. And now it's sort of turned the corner and it's sort of come back more into vogue. There are some trends and reasons for that. Some of them are pretty valid. Some of them are just sort of a correction of an overcorrection. But when you look at the evidence, so again, we like evidence, you have to start with, there was a huge study called the Women's Health Initiative Study. And the Women's Health Initiative Study hit the marketplace in right around 2002. The Women's Health, the Women's Health Initiative was actually funded by a company called Wyeth Ayrst. It's no longer in business, but they were the primary manufacturer of Premarin, which was probably the number one market share estrogen replacement at the time. And what they were trying to accomplish by backing this huge study was to show that it definitively made heart disease better. Now, it backfired. And it backfired largely because they pulled the study, at least one wing of the study, early, because when there was a combined estrogen and progesterone, it appeared that there was a slightly increased risk for strokes. And it was a significant enough risk that they felt that they didn't want to risk anybody taking hormones that might ultimately have a stroke. So they pulled the study early. Now, that was sort of unfortunate. It was how they built that study, and it was the right thing to do at the moment based on how they built the study.
These studies take years.
Yes,
to put together.
This one was, I think, in the fifth or sixth year of a 10-year cycle. So it was pretty deep into a long chunk.
Right.
They were I love this statistic. They were talking in woman years, which is 1 year for one woman. That's a woman year.
Okay.
And so if a woman does something for 10 years, that's 10 woman years. And if you add them all up, they had millions of women years in this study that they were looking at. Now And we always go back and sort of dissect and pick apart studies like this, especially the huge ones when there's lots of data. But with regards to the Women's Health Initiative, the risk for strokes went up about 8 per 10,000. The base risk of the placebo in the population study was right around 30, 31. The risk was up to something like 38 or 39 per 10,000. So still a pretty rare event.
Exactly.
But with that in mind, they looked at the statistical analysis of that and they said, well, we based on the way we've set up this study, we need to pull the study and alert people. Now, that was the progesterone and estrogen wing. The estrogen alone wing continued on through its 10 years, and it was largely overshadowed by everything that came up with the progesterone and estrogen wing of it. Interestingly, some versions of heart disease probably are improved by taking hormone replacement. Certainly, hot flashes and night sweats and bone strength, the big three that go along with menopause, were improved. Probably the best treatment for any of those three things is hormone replacement. Progesterone is added to estrogen whenever somebody has a uterus because it balances out the estrogen, and the theory there is that you're not going to overgrow the lining of the uterus and create a uterine cancer.
Okay.
We see definitely with both estrogen and with estrogen and progesterone and an improvement in certain cancers, things like colorectal cancer, for instance, seems to be improved. There have been all sorts of mixed mashed results with regards to breast cancer. Now, many breast cancers have estrogen receptors. They respond to estrogen. They grow when they see estrogen. Intuitively makes sense that if you give somebody estrogen that has a breast cancer, it's going to grow faster. There are a couple of huge pieces of evidence on this. Some of it came from the Women's Health Initiative. With the progesterone and estrogen wing of that study, we did see a predictable, very slight increased risk in development of breast cancer.
Very slight, maybe being the key.
Very slight, yeah. In fact, there's a statistical term we use called relative risk. And without getting into really boring details on statistics, if that number is one, it is considered the sort of the average risk. It's the same risk as if you weren't taking it, if you were just a general population risk. If it is over one, the more over one it gets, the more of a risk it becomes. And if it's less than one, it actually reverses the risk. So with that in mind, the relative risks on these things were like 1.1, 1.2, and they actually had a margin of error that overlapped the baseline. So with that, statistically speaking, with that, we say, well, we can't really draw any conclusions. It's not statistically significant, but it appears to be kind of a common trend. And this is something we've seen in other big studies, too. The theory being that estrogen or progesterone or both clearly make tumors grow that have estrogen receptors. Ironically, the numbers were just the opposite for the estrogen-only part of that. The estrogen-only part of that actually seemed to decrease risk, not statistically significant, but almost, in that very same huge millions of women year study. And so it's one of those things that leaves us all kind of scratching our heads. It doesn't make any sense. And so when people come in, this is usually the thing that they're most worried about. Most people aren't worried about strokes and clots, which is why that whole study was kind of shut down. It's a difficult thing to ferret out. And of course, we look at people's risks, among them breast cancer and blood clotting, you know, and any other factors that might affect things like smoking cigarettes, being overweight, hypertension, other medicines somebody might be on as to how that might affect their risk. These risks are pretty low when you're talking about a 50 or 51 or 52 year old. They get higher as you get older. Interestingly, in the Women's Health Initiative, the average age was 64, which is fairly old for this kind of treatment. Most of our hormone replacement folks are in their 50s. That was one of the criticisms of the study was, well, maybe this doesn't fairly reflect the people that we would normally treat. Interestingly, too, if I give somebody an antibiotic, I'm going to give them, you know, a few days worth of an antibiotic, enough to snuff out the infection, but not so much that they're not going to be on it for more than they have to be on it. So it's sort of a minimal amount for a minimal amount of time. Well, hot flashes in some people don't go away. They just keep coming. And most people, they do, are somewhat self-limited, but we're talking years. It's not something I can treat you this week and you'll be better next week. It's something you got to kind of fight for months and years and maybe decades. And so that's always been the trickiest part of this is, well, at what point is the line of safety kind of met? I like to tell the story, and you know, anybody out there listening that's been in my office asking for hormones will have heard this story probably, but I one time had an 89-year-old lady. This was back when we had charts, and I did not know this lady. I never met her, and I thought, oh, here we go. You know, I'm going to walk into this room with this 89-year-old lady, and I walked in. She was sitting on my exam table, had a little short skirt on, a visor, and a tennis racket slung over her shoulder, and before I could even say hello, she pointed her racket at me, and she threatened to to whack me with it if I took her hormones from her. And her internal medicine doctor had already tried, and I really wasn't in the mood to get beat up by an 89-year-old. So I said, yeah, whatever you're doing, lady, keep doing it.
Exactly. And, especially at 89.
Wrote the prescription. And you know, part of that, and I've thought about her often over the years because, you know, I'm sure that she was in 89 because she took hormones. What that does, you've got a person that's got good genetics, hardy constitution, right, living life right. She was out playing tennis and active and spunky. And you add hormones to that sort of general healthy mix, and you get good results. It's sort of an augmenter of good health. The average 65-year-old isn't that healthy. You know, the average 65-year-old has a number of problems, maybe a touch of diabetes, a little high blood pressure, maybe a little overweight, maybe smokes, you know. And so you kind of start combining all of these small risks, and all of a sudden that risk for strokes and other things goes up. So it's not a one-size-fits-all thing, unfortunately. And, you know, I think for me personally, when a 52-year-old walks in saying, I've got to treat my hot flashes, in that case, most of the time the risk is less than the benefit. And so when you look at the sort of the plus minus, it's worth taking. I don't know where that break even is for people, but we have this conversation about the Women's Health Initiative and risks and benefits basically every year. I start to get a little more hesitant when we hit 60. But there are people out there that, you know, and I feel personally as a doctor, it's my job to educate, but it's also a choice. And you always have to kind of look at, well, is the quality of living improved enough to kind of outweigh the risks, or at least in the mind of the patient? And have I done my job to educate them to make that decision?
You mentioned the 89-year-old. Now, once a woman is on hormone therapy, that doesn't necessarily mean she's going to be on it forever.
No, and the trend nowadays is just like with the antibiotics, the least amount for the least amount of time. So even though we're talking years, it's usually sort of a year-by-year-by-year thing until we get to the point where somebody either wants to come off, or we feel like now all of a sudden that risk is starting to outweigh that benefit. And it is an ongoing negotiation, for lack of a better term. Okay. Now, with regards to hormones, I mean, probably if you think of medicine, and I kind of do, as a market share, still the majority of the people that are out there are taking a commercial form of estrogen, if they're taking an estrogen. And there are pills. We have two big kinds. There are conjugated and what we call conjugated estrogens, which are a sort of a what I like to say, a potpourri of different versions of estrogen. They're derived from pregnant horses. People always come in and say, okay, I want a natural medicine. I say, there's nothing more natural than a pregnant horse. The others were originally a yam estrogen-based extract of just estradiol, which is the most clinically significant of all the potpourri of estrogens. And so you can get estradiol alone. It's the nice thing about that is that there are generic versions. It's a little cheaper. So a lot of times in this day and age, insurance companies are pushing us towards things that are cheaper, or patients are pushing us towards things that are cheaper. So a lot of times, you know, when we're substituting out a prescription, it goes to estradiol. There are a bunch of other concoctions. A lot of people use patches. There are, you know, twice-weekly patches, once-weekly patches that people can take. There are gels that people can take. There are even pharmacies that will sort of concoct their own, what they like to call, bioidentical versions of hormones. And it's kind of interesting. A lot of people that choose to go the bioidentical route want to do something that's either a little more natural. The same vat of estradiol is used to make the pills as it is to make the concocted stuff. But I think there is sort of a psychological component to that as well. When you take hormone replacement, it's there's a lot involved in that. And going to a pharmacist that's going to listen to your symptoms, maybe do some form of measurement of hormones, and maybe concoct something that's sort of specific to that person. I think it appeases a lot of people's sensibilities, although evidence, back to that word, doesn't really show that it's any better. And I think it's variable. You know, we worry a little bit about those things because on a national level, we've got an FDA. We've got, you know, your pill of estrogen is going to be pretty consistent. Whereas I'm really not sure what you're getting, you know, when you go exactly. have something built. But we work with people with all of those sorts okay. of things. There are sort of other versions. A lot of times we're treating specific symptoms like, say, vaginal dryness. We might use a vaginal-specific estrogen. Sure. Less of the stroke risk and less systemic effect. Won't make your hot flashes better, won't make your bones stronger, but it might help that one thing. We have things that are called SERMs. These are really hot in breast cancer. The biggest one is, or at least the original one, was tamoxifen, where you take basically a genetically modified version of an estrogen that does different things at different parts of the body. What we would love to have is a SERM that gets rid of your hot flashes but protects you from breast cancer. It doesn't cause uterine cancer, but allows you to have the appropriate moisture. Or
that's not on the market yet.
Well, you know, they're working on it. Okay. And there are new SERMs. I want to say there are probably 10 or 15 SERMs on the market, of which a couple are more popular. Mostly they're used in relationship to treatment and follow-up from breast cancer. A lot of people are on tamoxifen. Those are medicines that, you know, that have shown to do a lot of good for people. But, you know, we're still looking for that perfect combo of the good stuff and not the bad stuff. We also sometimes treat symptoms away from hormones. So, like I mentioned psychology before, well, it turns out that you can treat hormone issues like hot flashes and night sweats sometimes with antidepressants. And there are a few in particular, Effexor's one, that seem to work better than others. There's a multi-billion dollar, this is a whole topic to itself, industry on dietary supplements and these sorts of things, and of course soy and black cohosh and various combinations of that and primrose oil and other plant extracts are sold by the gross, you know, at every one of our grocery stores and pharmacies to women that are menopausal, with the idea that they may, you know, tamp down hot flashes and night sweats. The issue with that is if they work, which that's not really been shown to be true in a lot of these things, soy works, but to get a soy effect, you got to take a lot of soy. And it's more than just a soy latte, you know, in the morning. It's a lot of soy. And if it works, it probably has the same risk, because what we're doing is taking in what are called phytoestrogens, or chemicals that look like estrogen enough that they bind to those estrogen receptors to have some estrogen effect. So that's all. I have tons of patients, though, that are taking these things, that come in, they show me a bottle of this or that and say, what do you think? And I, every time I say, is it working? And if it's working, I say, keep doing it. You know, if it's not working, I say, stop wasting your money. Yeah, you know?
let's try something else.
Yeah.
Dr. Eric Seward, OBGYN at Woodlawn Hospital. And you're available for folks who want to talk further about this.
I am available.
Okay.
I am available.
And your office is?
Well, we're over at in the hospital, Woodlawn Hospital. We're up in the physician's offices on the east side of the hospital. I always have to think about which way that hospital faces. It's kind of at an angle, but I'm on the east side, right up above the emergency room and
second floor. Okay.
And we're available. We're online. We're in the phone book. We're available for appointments. Come and see me.
All right. Phone number?
I don't know it off the top of my head. That's a good question.
You can call in the switchboard at 3141 and they'll connect you right up.
They'll do it.
All right. Dr. Seward, any thoughts about a couple weeks from now, or I should say next month?
Well, I have. There are a lot of great topics.
Okay.
At one point or another, I'd like to get into some of the nuts and bolts of pregnancy. And one particularly hot topic we've got now is something called a free cell fetal DNA test. These are big tests that are coming on the market. They're taking the market by storm for some of our high-risk people. And it's kind of a neat thing. We can do, you can do blood work on the mom.
Okay.
You can get tons of genetic information at a screening level on the baby. You can even tell the gender of the baby.
Wow.
And people are, these are hot. Most people out there know that there's this test they can do to find out if it's a boy or a girl. I usually, you know, kind of hedge on that and say, you know, yeah, it's called an ultrasound. But that said, there are more and more people that are coming and getting these tests, and I think I've ordered two or three of them in the last couple of weeks. We're still primarily using them for our older patients,
okay.
People over 35.
Dr. Eric Seward, as always, thanks for the information today. Very valuable. We appreciate it.
Hey, thank you.
Thank you.